Hello YouTube viewers, welcome to my show Science Thursday. In today's episode, we're going to take a look at the interesting new topic around the block, smart grid. So let's dive right into it. So the idea of smart grid is very simple. As many of you know, electrons almost travel at the same speed of light. So basically there is no lag here. So if power companies, as in power manufacturers, be it coal fire power plant, be it LNG power plant, be it solar, if it's producing power, it must be consumed. That's the whole point. It must be consumed. Now, if there is a demand that goes too high and there is not enough power, you will have blackouts. So there is no buffer here. There is no protection sort of scenario. So basically balance must be maintained between supply and demand, and it must be maintained as close to real time as possible. So this is the whole idea of smart grid. It wants to allow for a better management and better balancing of supply and demand. Now, it will also improve the fact that it will increase stability. How it will do that? Let's say it can detect your power grid is starting to lose power. It can directly ask power from other grid aspects, as in like, let's say it could trigger a backup power plant, it could trigger a energy storage system, it could preemptively act on things. And it will also improve safety, because now there is much more data going through. You can predict things before they fail. This is crucial. Before they fail, you can predict it. Now, this will also allow us one very crucial aspect. As many of you know, almost all renewable energies are intermediary. Basically, they do not have this is 5 megawatts, you're gonna get 5 megawatt no matter what happens. Most of them are fluctuates a lot. Aside from geothermal, you really can't count on anything else. So suffice to say, introduction of smart grid will allow you to easily incorporate green technology into your system. So why we have so much interest into this? Now, first thing you have to understand, electricity is kind of old. It's almost one century old. So we've been using kind of old infrastructure. Like even the newest power line you can find, it's like running on the same principle that was introduced 50 years ago or 100 years ago. So suffice to say, the whole architecture itself, the basic principle, basic framework of the grid is very ancient. It hasn't been designed to handle exponential loads. It hasn't been designed with any backup or any contingency, or it was built with limited knowledge at that time, and it served us well. But we now need to replace it with something better. Then big data that it will gather, it will allow us to do better management. Now think of it this way. As many of you know, in science, if you have one molecule, took a look at one water molecule, you will never able to predict what it's gonna do. Now look large enough of them, now you know how water is gonna behave. You can make boats run on it, or you can make a chronoplanes run on it. So if trying to predict a behavior of, let's say, one household is flat out impossible, you do not know. But imagine collecting data on thousands of households or whole country, you will literally see a clear data point. Oh, in night, around this time to this time, they have a lot of power consumption. Around this time to this time, there is this kind of thing. Of course, it won't be precise. Okay, in 9 p.m., 10 seconds, 15 milliseconds, there's gonna be power spike. It's not gonna be like that, but you're gonna get a very good, clear picture. So the bigger the data, the better the management you're gonna get. Now, the sole reason why companies want to do this, as in the power manufacturer, is basically they want to improve system efficiency. Now, why does that matter to them? Let's say it's not environmental, then why does it matter to them? Think of it this way, they get paid from you. Your meter that is on your wall, it's what their source of income is. So if power is lost before it comes to that, they are losing that money flat out. They're losing it. So let's say they made 1000 megawatt and 100 megawatt was lost, flat out lost, before it even reached any meter. It's lost. It's flat out loss for the company. That's why they want to improve efficiency. Now let's say they can distribute power much more effectively, they can ensure the power lines don't heat up too much, increasing the losses, they will reduce that 100 megawatt that they were flat out losing to 10 to 15 megawatts of loss. So it will improve their finances. That, and many of money talks. So how does this actually work? Now this has three core components. Component number one, sensors everywhere. Basically many of you in USA or even in India would have start saying things of this nature. Basically sensors, wireless self-contained sensor that is transmitting data of like temperature, amperage, voltage, whatever have you, as much data as they can to a wireless network. The reason for this is like you can detect fault like this very quickly. So let's say you start detecting the, let's say this cable is designed for 100 amps and you start detecting it's already reaching 99 amps, you know sooner or later it's gonna give out. So you can, you know, trigger a shutdown to let it cool down, or you can send data to power companies like, hey, there is a fault or this cable is running way too hot, please, you know, send a mechanic to detect, or like, you know, what's going on. There may be a fault in transformer, there may be, you know, some physical damage to the cable, things of that nature. So this allows a very specific data point. So sensors everywhere is crucial. Not only this power line, in your home, in the power generation, everywhere, basically every link of the chain must have as many sensors as they can have, from temperature to frequency to voltage to amperage. These are the, you know, basic system. So of course on top of that there are other data points also, because like humidity and all things like that. Now you might be like, what will that help? Like, would knowing humidity help? Yes, that will directly allow you to understand how good or bad the air conditioning is gonna perform. So suffice to say, more data you have, awesome. Then we come to wireless communication. Now this may seem odd that they are on wire, why the heck they are not using it? The problem is either they have to lay down a completely new wire, which is idiotically expensive, or they have to send data through this power system itself, which because of they are one century old, it's not very optimum. So wireless communication plays a crucial role. It now ideally would people would want to put this on a spectrum or frequency that is completely independent for public domain, like it should not even be in public domain, so that way it will become unhackable. Then we come to smart solution. These two only lets you, like sensor allows you to data collect data, and wireless communication allows you to, you know, collect that collected data. Smart solution is the, you know, end solution. This is what will happen to you in your home. Now imagine in many Indian homes we have water pump that you know fill up our tanks. Now water pumps, while generally most of them are induction pumps, the moment you start them they send out a very powerful spike throughout the system, and transformer have to be built overbuilt, suffice to say, to handle that kind of spike. Now imagine we still have the overbuilt system, but now what we do, a meter is there communicating with each other, and it's like, okay, I start my water pump and boom, there is a spike. Now at that time, while the spike is happening, it's flat out blocking any other water pump in that transformer to activate. Now my spike is gone, things have stabilized, now other water pumps, one spike. Okay, now this way it's very stable. Now many of you know who works in server industry, this is also done for hard drives, because if all of the hard drive, let's say you have 45 hard drive, they all start spinning up at the same time, yeah, it's your power draw is gonna be crazy. So generally they do one, they do like that, so that way your components don't heat up. So even though your system, your transformer can handle this kind of spike load, it's generally wise to not give it that. So that way if you have smart meter implemented here, it can communicate to next house, hey, I'm triggering my water pump right now, please do not activate any big induction motor. So let's say even if user activated the water pump on his home at the same time, it will be like, okay, spike passed, 1 second later it will trigger it on. Heck, it may be so fast people won't even realize it. So this is the end, this is what will happen to you, end user. So are there any cons to this? Yes. Now, biggest con is this is very vulnerable to cyber attack. As many of you know, in recent time, the prevalence of what we call DDoS attack, basically denial of service attack, because this is wireless, it has to be wirelessly communicated. There is a lot of bandwidth that must be consumed. Now, if it's completely independent, even then it still would be vulnerable, because if you directly get into that wireless network, you can send corrupted data. And I'm not even assuming malice. I'm not even assuming that you want to clip, you know, collapse the grid. Maybe accidentally, you know, one sensor sent out the wrong data and it, you know, shut down the grid. Like, because sensor says detecting failure, please shut down. And, you know, computer will react like that. Oh, there is a failure, but there was no failure and boom, they shut down the grid. So there is a very serious vulnerability. And not to mention, if somebody really wants to cripple it, now they can. Before it was, as many of you have seen in the movie Die Hard 4, to collapse electrical, they have to go there. They have to actually, you know, enter the power production plant. Here they don't have to do that. They can hack like hundreds of small points and then say overload the data. So this makes it vulnerable to cyber attack, and it must not be taken lightly. Then we come to the final fact. That's why it's not happening already. It's very expensive. You are talking about relays, basically, at the end of the day, at end user. Now, many of you know who have worked with electronics, relays are very complicated. So, and not to mention, to build an electronic that can handle this sort of, you know, request, like, okay, I'm gonna wait until, you know, power spike passes. Okay, power spike pass, now I'm gonna start it. It's not that you're gonna do it one day. It's, you're supposed to do that continuously for 10 years, minimum. Nobody's gonna buy a power meter like this to put in their home when there is like, yeah, you have to replace it every 1 year or 2 year, like your mobile phone. So you have to understand, so they inherently built this system to last. Like, this is a commercial application. Like, even though an end user, a homeowner is having this, this must last. This is not something that anybody is comfortable with, like, oh yeah, meter. And not to mention, this also means lost revenue. So if this breaks and they are still using electricity, company cannot charge it. And if company charges it, oh, I'm gonna charge you a ludicrous amount of money, people will flat out throw away this meter. So suffice to say, it's very expensive. And this is very cold cold truth about this situation, is that this is not a solution. It will not change anything. It will not make us like, you know, okay, now we have solved a problem. It's just better management of the resource we have. So all the video that I find online, many of them is kind of like overselling, is that, you know, this is the next big thing. Yes, it is, but it's more like management. It's not like, oh, now we randomly have nuclear fusion. So suffice to say, I do find this kind of blind optimism around these things. It's like, you know, this is like going to solve our problem. It's not going to solve our problem. It's just, at best case scenario, it's going to allow us to reduce our losses, do better management, better predictability, reduce the time, spike demands, basically. And you can know, predict, and all of these combined will help us to, you know, reduce carbon emissions. So it has a very serious impact, however, not that magical impact that people are looking for. Then what we can expect in the future? Now, first, reduce cost. As many of you know, electronic cost has been going down steadily. So either they make a very expensive smart meter, or have a smart meter with a redundant part. So it might as well have externally accessible chip controller, basically whole motherboard that you slot in. You slot in two. One is always working. It fails, you replace it, and the second one takes the load. It's done in server industry, where they call it hot swapping. Things of that nature is possible. There are many other solutions also. They might build a fault tolerant system. They might build a system which can predict before it fails, or they simply build it better. So there are many options, and all of this will help us to reduce the cost, that inherent painful cost. Now, as many of you know, older wireless system used to cost like an arm and a leg. Now it's your Bluetooth headset has wireless communication. So cost is going down. Now, because this will generate an immense amount of data, a human cannot pass through this data. At best, a human can pass through, let's say, 50-60 factories are happening. He can check the graph and, like, you know, calculate. But imagine that kind of graph is coming from every single home. To handle that kind of data throughput, you need AI implementation. AI can easily predict things before they happen. Like, recently, many of you must have heard about Watson AI, built by IBM. It's a medical AI. Basically, it is supposed to help doctors, say, you know, make better diagnostics. And all things considered, it already started to predict things that doctors were missing. Not because doctors were incompetent, simply because doctors did not have the data point. Like, it had data of millions of reports, and doctors barely do a million patient in their whole lifetime. Then Watson was going through millions of data points per hour. So AI can predict things much more effectively, and because we are collecting big amount of data, AI is a very crucial point for this. So all things considered, I really think AI implementation is gonna be the key. Now, if we did this all well, like if we did the implementation, if we did the management properly, it will also reduce this need for, you know, grid scale power storage. So if you don't have smart integration, you have to do what's called brute forcing it, where you simply like, okay, just build a powerhouse big enough that can handle it, build enough backup generator that can handle it, build, you know, just overbuild everything. Not only that's very wasteful, it's also very polluting. So let's say you shouldn't need, like, you know, power storage system, but if you need it should not be like, you know, you need to build of 2 gigawatt or 5 gigawatt energy storage. Few megawatt should be there to, you know, help smooth things out. So right now, like this is a picture of 50 megawatt supposed plant, like they are under construction. So all things considered, the better the smart grid becomes, the smaller scale grid storage we will need. As I've already made a video about grid scale storage, all things considered, we can't really make a grid scale storage that stores terabytes of terawatts of power. So all things considered, if we can reduce the need of it by implementing smart grid, it's gonna be very crucial for us. So this was my presentation on smart grid. I hope you liked it or learned from it. In that case, please leave a like, share it amongst your friend. I would urge you to do so. And if you haven't liked it, no problem with that. You can dislike it. And I would say, leave a comment what you wanna see in the next episode of Science Thursday. And if you have really watched it this far, thank you. And please subscribe, press the bell icon if you are free. And as always, thanks for watching.